فإن صرها قبل فراق لقائه فليس بمأمون عليها سرورها. متى تبصر القدس عتيقة مرة فسوف تراها العين حيث تديرها. Assalamu alaikum, everybody. This is your Arabic teacher Sam, and a very warm welcome back to another episode of Wednesday Walkthroughs. Obviously, in this one, we're just going to run over the last bit of this poem that we're going to be covering. If you haven't caught up on the previous two lessons, then just go back in this playlist, inshallah, and catch up on them. Because this is a poem called Fil Quds by a writer called Tamim Al Barghouthi. And and he's a Palestinian poet, and this is a poem about the city Jerusalem, Al Quds. And, at the top here, obviously, we've got these kind of, these six lines, these six abiyat of poetry. And, we've just been running through them. We've kind of done a pair at a time. So now we've come on to the last of them. So as you heard, I read from فَإِن صَرَّهَا قَبْلَ الْفِرَاقِ لِقَاؤُهُ فَلَيْسَ بِمَأْمُونٍ عَلَيْهَا سُرُورُهَا مَتَى تُبْصِرِ الْقُدْسَ عَتِيقَةَ مَرَّةً فَسَوْفَ تَرَاهَا الْعَيْنِ حَيْثُ تُدِيرُهَا. Okay, so let's walk through it. Let's put our Arabic boots on and let's walk through it. So فَإِن is like saying so if. Okay, if is in a lot of the time. In Arabic, there are two kinds of if clauses, really. There's one that is, if you do this, and then this will happen. You know, it's sort of conditional. It's things that can actually happen. They're sort of realizable if clauses. If you work hard, then you will learn Arabic. You know, if you go to work, you will get paid. You know, things that you can actually do. And you use in or ith or ither for those ones. But for ones that are kind of hypothetical, when we're saying something like, if only, you know, if only I'd chosen to do this, or if only he had done that, then you use low. Low is the way you say if in those cases. So what do we have? So we have, so if sarraha. So we've seen the term surur to mean kind of happiness. So if they are happy. So if they are happy, qabla al-firaqi. So if they are happy, and then we have the qabla, which means before, al-firaq. The term farq means a difference, really, but firaq in this case means like the departure, which kind of makes sense with two things kind of separating, becoming apart from each other. So if they were happy before the departing, the meeting. So if they're happy, if they have happiness with the meeting before the departure, you know, that's what it really means. So there's a little bit of word order change. It's a bit easier for our kind of English mind to think. And so if they're happy with the meeting before the departure, rather than if they're happy before the departure with the meeting. That's just a little bit easier for the English ear. But liqa, is the meeting, liqa. It's even used to do with meeting your Lord, like on the Day of Judgment. Liqa. Liqa'a Rabbi. Liqa'i Rabbihim, or something like that. I've heard that before. But with the meeting of their Lord, it's even used with that too. Okay, so if you imagine, like, there's, honestly, when I was reading through this poem, and when I do preparation for these lessons, I think, like, it's such a colossal task to try to convey the depth in the meaning of this. Like this is talking about the experience of being in Jerusalem, right? And, like, a lot of the time when people come to Jerusalem, even Palestinians come to Jerusalem, they can't stay there. Like, they might be allowed to go there. They might be allowed to go there like once in their lives. Or I know that especially for visiting Masjid al-Aqsa, the Israeli military might only let people enter who are over the age of like 40 or over the age of 50 or something. Sometimes that rule changes. But so, I mean, you know, that there's kind of contextual things that play into that. Like, let's complete this whole bait. We'll go to the next shatr and we'll fill in the gap. So, فَلَيْسَ بِمَأْمُونٍ. Now you can see over here. So, فَلَيْسَ بِمَأْمُونٍ. This fa is also kind of saying so. Laysa is a way of saying not. It's the most common way of saying not, really. But you can, you know, it's one of the sisters of kana. So you would say something like, if you'd say like, it's not good. Yeah, just keep a nice simple example. You'd say like, laysa jayyidan. It is not good. Or you can say laysa bijayyidin. Those two mean the same things. I heard in a khutbah when I was in the Netherlands last. It was a Moroccan masjid in Breda. If any of you are from Breda, you might know the masjid I'm talking about. It's mostly Moroccans that pray there. Anyway, so and the imam said, هذا الفهم, this understanding, ليس صحيحاً. And then he said the same thing again. He said, هذا الفهم ليس بصحيحٍ. He said the same thing twice, just as if it was for the benefit of me, for the Arabic students there. But he said, yeah, هذا الفهم, this understanding, ليس بصحيحٍ. هذا الفهم ليس صحيحاً. Because they mean the same thing. ليس صحيحاً, it's not correct. ليس بصحيحٍ, it's not correct. But here the writer, for whatever reason, and probably a combination of reasons, has said, فليس بمأمونٍ. So مأمون means it's kind of safe. It's been secured. So it is not secured. عليها سروروها. The surur, the happiness, is not secured upon it. You know, if you're happy with a meeting that's going to end soon, you're going to have to depart soon, then this happiness isn't secured. You know, it's not going to be long-lasting happiness. It's just like a temporary happiness. You know, like if, I don't know, let's say, like, just an example that comes to mind, like if you went to prison or something and, like, you're allowed to see your child or your wife or your husband or whatever for, like, 5 minutes a week. Like, as soon as you meet them, you're going to be thinking about, oh, 5 minutes, they're going to have to depart. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's that, the happiness. You can't feel the real happiness because you're going to have to go soon. Anyway, like that's kind of the meaning of this whole bait. Good. Let's go on to the next line. Meta. Meta is kind of saying when. Meta tubsir. When you see. Al-Quds al-Atiqata. So Al-Quds, we've seen that a number of times before. Al-Quds. So when you see Jerusalem, Al-Atiqa. I used to teach a girl called Atika, a Bangladeshi girl called Atika. I don't know if her name is actually from the term Atiq. But anyway, Atiq, when I hear it, I think it sounds like it's vintage. Like when I hear something being Atiq, it's like it's vintage. It has the connotation of being like old-fashioned. I think like antique. I don't know if the word atiq actually has any relationship with the word antique. I love a good bit of etymology, so if any of you guys know that, if you know about that, then I'd love to know if you know if the word antique has anything to do with the word atiq, because they sound similar, don't they? But Tamim al-Balghuthi here is saying al-Quds al-Atiqa, is saying like our ancient Jerusalem. It's not really just ancient. There's a meaning of majesty in it. Like there's a kind of like quality, antiquious or something, if that's a word. When you see the antiquious Jerusalem, there's a lot of antiquity there. I don't know. Hopefully, the sort of words surrounding the meaning of atiq has kind of given you an idea of what it means. Marratan is just a time. So when you see, you know, the antiquious Jerusalem, a time, when you see it one time. Well, yeah, when you see it, not if you see it. Did I say if? Hopefully I just said when, because meta means when. فَسَوْفَ, then تَرَاهَا. So سَوْفَ is translates just really closely to our English word will. Just if you ever use a present tense verb after it, سَوْفَ just puts it in the future. Similar to the role of the word will in English, like if you say I eat, which means I eat, but if you say I will eat, it means that it puts in the future. سوف does a very similar job to that. فسوف تراها. فسوف ترى. ترى is from the verb رأى. We see this really often. It's a really common verb, and it's but it needs to be treated on its own terms, because it's very irregular. I've heard my Arabic teachers used to tell me that it is the only irregular verb in Arabic. Like if you're used to studying other languages like French or Spanish or Italian or whatever, you'll be used to learning like lists of words that are irregular verbs for certain reasons, and you call them all irregular. But in Arabic, like the Arabic grammarians would rather not say this is a rule and this is an irregular verb. They'd just say these are all rules. There's not irregular verbs, there are just loads of different rules. But ra'a is really the only verb that behaves the way it does. It's just got some funny things in it. Like, I mean, it's got a hamza and an alif maqsura in it, and that just means that when it's conjugated, it behaves in a funny way. So you will see it. The ha, tara ha. the hair on the end is referring back to the Al-Quds Al-Atiqah. And this is a little rule, actually. If a word or if a verb ends in an alif maqsura, then you need to add a pronoun on the end, like hair or hu, it'll always turn into an alif tawila. So that's why it's taraha with an alif tawila, taraha. So you will see it, so we'll see it, okay? Taraha really would mean you see it, but we're about to find out that you are not the subject of the sentence. Al-ayn is the subject. How do we know it's the subject? Cheeky dhamma on the top. That's usually the giveaway. So when the eye will see it, haythu. Haythu is a way of saying when. Not necessarily to do with time though. Haythu, like in a, haythu is kind of like in a circumstance, in this kind of circumstance. Haythu tudiruha. Tudiruha. Very nice. Tudiru surely must come from the verb adara then. Adara, yudiru. Very similar to arada, yuridu. Adara, yudiru. Yudiru, yudiru. Means to circle around something. Haythu tudiruha. When you circle around it. So let's try to piece that together, inshallah. So let's just call it the ancient Jerusalem. Okay, it doesn't really mean ancient. Ancient would probably be qadima, but let's just call it that, just so I don't have to say a word like antiquitous. So when you see the ancient Jerusalem, a time, the eye will see it from everywhere. That's kind of what it means. But really what it means is once you've seen Jerusalem, you will see it everywhere. Like, you will, like, whenever you, even when you go home and stuff, you'll feel nostalgia towards Jerusalem. You know, like if you go somewhere, like even now, like when I, you know, like when I'm home, if I ever go to a restaurant and they sell knafe, it's like I see Nablus. Do you know what I mean? Like, there are just things that I miss. Do you know what I mean? I'll miss things about it. You know, once you've been there, once you've been to Jerusalem, you know, even when you're not physically there, you'll always be seeing it around you. You know, there'll always be things that will be reminding you of it. I mean, that's my interpretation of it anyway. I mean, obviously, always with poems, there's deeper levels of, it's always layered in its meaning and stuff. So that's kind of how I read it, and that's how I kind of interpret it. But and that is kind of the nuts and bolts of what the words themselves actually mean. But sometimes even when we learn something in a lughawi sense, in a ma'anawi sense, like in literally just the meanings of the words, you need context as well to see behind the words, and you know. So yeah, but that's the very best I've done. You know, I think that this poem is a little bit advanced, I think, for a lot of people who are just general casual, you know, YouTube students of the Arabic language. So I've decided to, we'll stop this poem here. We've delved into it a little bit. We've done 3 videos on it, and it's quite nice. And at the beginning, I gave you guys a nice little intro into the study of Arabic poetry generally. And I think that was quite valuable for a lot of people. I know a lot of you enjoyed it. But we're going to move on to a new text next week. I think it would be good just for us to do a fairly simply written novel. You know, if we can have a novel that's just quite simple in Arabic, like if we got hold of a novel that we're familiar with, you know, would be nice, like something that's been translated. Maybe like a John Steinbeck novel or something. I remember seeing some John Steinbeck novels in the library when I was in Palestine. Some of them have really funny translations, you know. There's often, you know, when you have novels that we know of in English, like I think there's a John Steinbeck novel. The one I'm thinking of is Grapes of Wrath. I think that's a John Steinbeck novel, and it's called like Anaqid al-Ghadab in Arabic. Anaqid doesn't really mean grapes; it means like bunches. Anqud is a bunch, but Anaqid is the plural. It's like bunches of ghadab, of wrath. It's kind of, rather than being grapes of wrath, it's sort of bunches of wrath. Doesn't sound quite as threatening. Well, grapes don't either, really. Let's wrap this video up, inshallah, before I delve too much into how aggressive different fruits are. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any suggestions for things that we could continue our Wednesday walkthroughs with, please let me know, and I'll have a look at them, and I'll be very open-minded to them. because I think this is beneficial for a lot of people. Even if you would like me to go back to another story in the story of the Prophet's book, because a lot of people really benefited from that, alhamdulillah. You know, we went through the story of Hud alayhi salam. We could do another prophet. You know, we could do Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. We could do, if you do want to do any of those stories, I actually have a free course, by the way. You can get access to it. It's like just a 6-step mini course. If you're into reading stories of the prophets and stuff, then I teach a lot of the grammar that we actually need for that book. I'll link it up in the description, inshallah, if that's for you. It's free. Six video lesson, you get a hold of it, see what you think of it. And so then we'll carry on, inshallah. Tomorrow's video is grammar time. We're back to grammar time episodes. I know I missed one last week because I was on Islam Channel last week, so I was busy, so I couldn't put out the episode last week. But we have our episode of grammar time coming up tomorrow. Grammar time is on Thursdays now, because if you were around yesterday, you watched the video from yesterday, we did we're doing Tuesday talkthroughs. Tuesday talkthrough, Wednesday walkthrough. Yeah, I planned that deliberately. If you missed it, go back and watch it, inshallah. It's quite beneficial. Cool. Let's put an end to it. I'll put you guys out of your misery. Come back tomorrow for grammar time. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.